One of the worst things to do is to be with someone where you've got to hide a portion of who you are. For those who gather on tonight, we're grateful. Reverend Smith and I were joking just a minute ago that we've never had this many people at a CAYA worship before. Joe said, well, it's because you're talking about relationships and everybody comes out when you start talking about relationships. And so we're going to be in prayer because I believe what I want to share tonight needs a few caveats, a few words of warning. The first one is that I've spent a lot of time in prayer preparing for this, and there are some things that I want to share that I know are going to be difficult to digest. But I believe it would be a waste of our time to come out and try to sugarcoat some rough realities that God says some of us need to hear. And please know that as I share what I believe God's placed on my heart, I'm not only convicting you, I'm indicting me, that some of what I say is even hard for me to hear. But the Lord has to speak to us tonight on one of the most critical areas of our lives, and that would be our relationships. If you think about it, for many of us, our relationships are the area that has remained off limits to God. Typically, this is how we get into relationships. You see what you want, you pursue it, you get in it, and then you pray for God to fix it when it's broken. Right? That very rarely are we in a place of searching for God's will about the ones who we are romantically involved with. And so I know what I'm going to share tonight, I believe, comes from the Lord, and I need you to hear that. I am not speaking out of my own authority, because God knows I have messed up enough relationships in my life that there's some folk who don't want to come to church today because they knew me way back when. And all of us have that history of having gone through some things relationally. And please know that I'm trying to teach from the Word of God tonight, and I want to make sure you hear this, because if the Lord speaks to you tonight, I need you to make sure you give credit to the Lord. I'll tell you a quick story about my first death threat as a pastor. My first death threat as a pastor, yeah, these things happen. My first death threat as a pastor came in Springfield, Massachusetts, when I was pastoring. And there was a young lady I cannot name because she may be watching tonight. I gave a message and challenged the level of holiness, and that caused her to go home and put out a man she'd been living with for several years. And I was at the barber shop a few weeks later, and my barber let me know, yo, this dude came by here. He knows you get your hair cut here. He's looking for you. That's what he means, he's looking for me. He said, yo, he said he's got some beef with you and y'all gonna have a misunderstanding and that he was gonna put a bullet in yo. Right? I'm trying to figure out, why does this dude got beef with me? And this is what my barber said. He said, well, because he said this girlfriend came home and told him that you told her he gotta go. And because she went home and told her man, Pastor Wesley said, you got to leave. You know, he had issue with it, and he was coming after me. So I only say that to say, if God talks to you tonight, and you're challenged to go home and do something, can you please, please give credit to the Lord for this one? I'm going to let folk know I was at church on Wednesday, and I heard God speak to me, and God told me I need to do such and such and do this and that. And so tonight we're trying to listen to the Lord speak about some difficult things. I also want to acknowledge that no one is an expert in relationships. Nobody. All relationships are different. And I don't dare stand to speak as one who can tell you definitively what you ought to do. As a matter of fact, I think one of the worst scenarios are people who have been married successfully for years and come to believe that their way of marriage is the only way to survive. And then they begin to cast judgment on you in relationships based upon how they made it, when the reality is everybody travels a different road of love and life. And what leads you to however you define success may be dramatically different than the person sitting right next to you. So I hope that we can avoid judgment and know that some things I share tonight, you are free and encouraged to debate, to deny, to say that's not how the Lord is leading me. That's well within your right, because I am not an expert on relationships. But I do stand to speak out of my own experience, my own time in counseling people in difficult relationships, the majority of what I do pastorally with someone with the ages of 25 to 40 typically deal with relationships. And people coming, and I see some commonalities and universal trends that kind of inform what I want to share tonight. But you're definitely free to debate it. And what I'm going to share tonight doesn't apply to everybody. There are different categories of people in here tonight. There are those who are single and satisfied. There are those who are single and searching. There are those who are married and happy. There are those who are married and miserable. There are those who may be called into a relationship and a marriage, and there's some who may be called into a season of being single. So there's no one universal rule that applies to everyone. What I do want to know, just to kind of begin, I need to know how many of you all, I'm going to ask you in a minute to raise your hand, are single. And by single, that doesn't mean that you don't have a significant other. It just means that there's no ring on the finger. If you're single, let me see your hand, all the single folk. Okay. So that's about the bulk of us. All the married folk. Married folk in the house, how many married couples? All right. He stood up and said, "Yes, Lord." Praise God for you all as well. I pray that nothing I share challenges married couples, but rather strengthens their relationships. Let's bow in prayer, and then we're going to get into what I believe God wants to say. God, I thank you tonight that your spirit can be real with us, that you know who we are, both the public face and the hidden sins. And Lord, there's no point coming to you tonight if we're not going to veil our entire life to you. So Lord, my heart, my dreams, my desires, my habits, my patterns, I lay them all before you. And I give you divine permission to speak to the very sensitive areas in my life. Come, Holy Spirit, arrest our hearing, our doing, our thinking, our believing. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let me begin by suggesting that for the bulk of us in this place tonight, if I were to ask you what your life looks like at its best, if you could shape the destiny of your life and how things would work out for you, maybe this year, next year, 10 years down the road, I'd probably be a safe bet to suggest that for many of us, part of what defines good living and happiness and joy would be the experience of falling in love, growing in that love, and then staying in that love. That I believe it's safe to say that most of us desire to be in a real relationship with someone who is ordained by God to help us fulfill our life purpose. And most of us are single would ask that God would send someone in our life who's ride or die, somebody who can stand the good, the bad, and the ugly about you and still never leave. Somebody that you can be your most honest self with. One of the worst things to do is to be with someone where you've got to hide a portion of who you are. And you'll recall that I shared with you a few lessons ago that secrets suffocate. And that when you've got to hide some of who you are from someone you're with, ultimately that's going to suffocate you, because the most freeing relationships are the one where you can take your mask off and be who you are, and yet be connected to someone who pushes you to be better than what you are, not by criticism, not by judgment, and not by guilt, but someone whose very presence makes you want to step up who you are. That because they are who they are and you value them, you want to bring your best self to the table. That a good relationship encourages you to be a better you for the sake of the person that you're with. That many of us want to desire to be in a relationship with someone you can share your life with. That one of the signs you know you're maturing is that you really do want to grow old with someone. No one wants to be 80 and alone. But to have someone in your life who's been there for an appreciable amount of time, someone who knows you, Someone you don't have to explain all your feelings to. They know and can predict how you're going to respond because they've been there long enough and they accept that you're not a perfect person and they love you anyhow. Many of us, I dare say, want to be in a relationship that the greatest love songs are written about. That when you hear them, you can envision yourself with somebody. Someone who inspires you to be faithful to them. To love them for a lifetime. My deepest desire is to be with someone that if by chance they die, I'd never want to be with another woman. Because the thought of who I had will never be greater than who can be. If you know within your heart that deep down your desire may not be to be there today, but that description kind of fits what you would like to see happen in your life, just raise your hand. If that's where you think you want to be in life. Many of us want to be there. Now, I know that some of you in this place are a little marriage adverse because you've seen the reality of married couples around you. And if I'm willing to bet, most of us have seen more bad marriages than good ones. You know people who are married and miserable. You know that couple that brags about being married for 50 years, but they ain't slept in the same room for 20 of them. Or you know that married couple where the one you're friends with is unfaithful. You know the marriages that have gone through divorce for whatever reason. And many of us may come in with kind of our guards up about marriage. I've spoken to more young people who have no desire to get married. They are open in saying that marriage is not for them. They'd rather have a series of monogamous relationships than to stand at the altar and make a covenant commitment. But if you've ever seen a truly happy married couple, you'll witness that there's no greater thing in life than two folk who really love each other, have stood at the altar, have made a vow and have been faithful to it. It's an encouraging thing to see a couple who truly loves each other after years of marriage. There's a couple in our church, and I know they're not here tonight because they're at least in their 80s, and I know they ain't here. And I don't think they would mind me telling you about them. They're the Shaws, Vance and Lois Shaw. And whenever I see Vance and Lois Shaw in church, I used to get irritated by them. They've been married years. They're up in their 80s. I know they've been married at least 40, almost 50 years. They've been married so long that when they come to church, they always match their outfits. You know? You know that kind of couple. Really? Y'all got to dress alike every Sunday. I mean, literally, they dress alike every Sunday. You know, and you know they're married, and they get cuddled up in church. I mean, it's praise and worship. You ain't supposed to be putting your arm around nobody. I used to look at that and be like, man, that's ridiculous. But let me tell you when the Lord really, really moved my heart with Vance and Lois Shaw. We had our biannual cookout this past year down at the grounds of Virginia Theological Seminary. About 3,000 church members gathered out for our barbecue, our cookout. And with 3,000 people, everybody's kind of spread around. And I noticed off in the corner that Vance and Lois had set up two chairs underneath a tree where there was some shade. And so I'm doing my rounds as pastor. I decided I'm going to walk by and go say hello. And I get over there only to find out they're asleep. Right? But they're holding hands. Right? And y'all, I'm serious. I stood there and looked at him for like a good 5 minutes. I know it's kind of creepy, but I was like, man, yo, that's what I want. I want to be 80, dressed like my boo. Like, sitting in the shade, holding hands, sleep. Like, Lord, take me right now, because it don't get. I tell you what, don't that beat drama? Don't that beat ugly? Yes, Joy, the answer is yes. Don't say no. Question is, you know, how do we get there? How do you get to be Vance and Lois Shaw? Well, I found that two things happen when you begin to mature in your life that revolve around relationships. Number one is that you know you're maturing where you reach the point where you really do desire to share both your success and your struggles with the one same person. That maybe in the 20s, it's fun and exciting to be in different relationships or to be free and independent. But when the Lord really starts opening the door of success on your career and with it comes the door of struggle, you want to share it with someone. It's no fun just going home alone. You want someone to be there. And as you get older, you begin to recognize, and this is how I know I'm talking to mature people tonight. You begin to recognize that dating gets gets old. The cycle of meeting, hooking up, finding out they ain't who they said they were, them changing and flipping the script, going through the drama and the ugly that ultimately leads to the breakup, only to start all over again. After a while, y'all, that cycle really gets old. And it's the wearing out of that cycle that opens up many people's hearts to the idea and the possibility of wanting to be with someone long-term in a covenant commitment that God has ordained. Now, the trouble with that is that when that day begins to dawn on you and that season comes, I have found that there are some dangers around reaching the point of realizing that you want to be with someone, that your heart is ready, that it's your season to look for your mate, your soulmate. The two real dangers that have crept up that I see repeatedly, number one is that many people then reach a place where they fall in love with falling in love. That they enjoy the process and the romance and the emotions. Y'all, falling in love is a magnificent thing. Staying in love is a difficult one. And all of us know some folk who like falling in love, and the problem with that is that their emotions are oftentimes stronger than their discernment. And so they miss signs because they enjoy the emotional ride. And don't recognize that from the very beginning, this may not have been someone you were called to be with, but because you enjoy the initial stages. You know what? All relationships are cool in the first 6 weeks. That's when they're at their best. It's when the mask comes off and the struggle and the strain comes and the anger comes and the stresses come that you begin to realize that there's more than being in love that's necessary to make a relationship work. And I've said this time and again, love is not enough to make a marriage last. Love can be a deep-seated emotion, but in and of itself, it is not a strong enough foundation by itself to lead you to happily ever after. And the problem is that love can be so strong, you miss the signs of all the other stuff that is missing because you're all warm and fuzzy. The second thing that I find happens is not only are there people who fall in love with being in love, but there are people who are attracted to the idea of a wedding without knowing the reality of marriage. It's a shame to reach that point where you allow what you think is a clock ticking to pressure you into a place of desperation to accept that you want to get into a marriage when you really don't understand the reality of what it takes to be married. Hear me, do you know why most marriages end in the first 2 years? Because one or two problems happen. They get in the marriage and find out that either they or the person they marry does not have the strength to be married. Marriage takes a strength that many people have not developed prior to being married, and that is the ability to sacrifice for something greater than your own desires. And if you've never practiced sacrificial living, if you never practiced surrendering, If you've never practiced submitting, then you're going to have difficulty in marriage, because marriage only works when you decide that it doesn't matter if I'm right if we wind up being wrong. Right? And many people don't have the strength, and they wind up getting divorced. Or they wind up recognizing they married the wrong person. And hear me, this is a tough pill to swallow. He or she can be good, and that doesn't mean that God ordained you to be together. And the mistake many of us make is that we think that if I'm good and she's good, that we ought to be able to make it good, but not if it isn't in God's will for you. And sometimes you can hook up with a good person who's the wrong person. Now, because of that, I need to let you know that that strikes at the heart of two fundamental differences between men and women. Can I slide into second base right here and just talk? Now, I know that there's stereotypes that don't apply. I ain't saying that all sisters are one way and all brothers are another way. Now, I'm not saying that at all. And I know you may be the exception to the rule, but you may be the only one on your pew, because I know what I'm about to say is, in general, the truth about a difference between a man and a woman. Women are triggered into a desire to be married when they believe they've met their Adam. Most women tend to believe that there is a man whom the Lord has shaped in his mother's womb to be your Adam. And when you believe you've met Adam, you are ready to open your life to marriage, because that's the one whom the Lord created for you, and now life can begin in purpose because you found your Adam. But for brother, sister, it's a very different thing. What triggers a man's desire to marriage is not necessarily believing he's found his one and only Eve, but rather that now he's in the time in his life when marriage is appropriate. Hear the difference. The time is right for the woman when she's met Adam. But for Adam, it's right when he gets to the right season of his life. And if you happen to be Miss Eve of Miss Day, then he's open. Now, sisters, let me tell you why that's real. Because, maybe not you, but you have a girlfriend who dated a dude for a long season. It looked like everything was right. He didn't want to get married. They broke up, and 3 months later, he was engaged to somebody else. Right, right. Ooh, pastor, then got real. And you asked the wrong question. You're asking what was wrong with me. And the question may have nothing to do with you. It was whether or not this brother reached the time in his life where he believed he was open to whom the Lord would call into him, because for a man, it's triggered by time. But for a sister, it's triggered by Adam. But in either case, it is the Lord who suggests, both in time and in Adam, that it's not good for man to be alone, that the Lord gives Adam the right season and brings the right woman. That it's the Lord who presents to him the right woman at the right time. And one of the things I want to suggest to you is that you've got to trust that God knows who the right person is, and God knows how to place you in the right place at the right time to present to you the one whom he has ordained to partner with you in life. How many people trust and believe that God has a plan for your relationships? Right? You ought to, because if not, you will continue to try to fabricate it on your own. You've got to trust and believe that the Lord has a plan. Now, what I wish God would do that God doesn't do is that God puts Adam to sleep, shapes Eve, wakes him up, and says, here. Right? Nobody else. This is the one I made for you. I wish that that's the way God did it, that you just woke up one day and on your doorstep was a brother or sister with a card that said, I'm the one, Lord, send into your life. Wouldn't that be so much easier? But the reality is, anybody who does that, I think you're weird. Right? Look, I don't trust any sister that tells me the Lord told her she's supposed to be the one. Because the Lord knows me, and the Lord knows how to talk to me, and the Lord knows what I like. and you ain't it. I mean, we want God to do it that way, but you'd be kind of creeped out by someone who kept pressing up on you, telling you the Lord told them that y'all supposed to be together. So how do you find Adam? How do you find Eve? How do you find the right season? You got to go through the difficulty of discerning through dating. That's the only way you get to know. You're discerning through dating. Now, that means one of the very first questions you need to ask relationally, what is the purpose of dating for you? And there are only one of two answers. And if you hook up with someone who doesn't share the same answers, y'all gonna have a problem, right? So one purpose can be just having fun. Just killing time, right? On to the next one. Y'all be chase some. I thought this was Kaya. Y'all be chase some, I replay some. You know, that's Jay-Z. Come on, lighten up. I mean, and really, there's nothing wrong if you're in that season of life. We just want to meet, greet, decide to move on. Could be just something to do. Or dating could be for you trying to discern time and Adam. Is it the right season? And who's the right person? And you got to be clear on that when you're in dating relationships, because if you're on different pages of that, it's going to become a problem. You're just looking to have fun, right? And I'm not talking about even an ungodly way. There's a godly way to date and have fun, but you're not looking forward to matriculate and mature in anything. But if you hook up with someone who believes that this is supposed to be going somewhere, there's going to be frustration, right? Because they have a different end game to dating than you do. What is the purpose of dating? Well, the Bible is filled with examples of relationships worthy of examining. But none of them, to me, are as insightful for this subject matter as the one I asked you to read in the book of Judges. If you haven't, I'm going to ask you to read it because we're going to come back to this next month again. I need you to read Judges 13 through Judges 16 in the Old Testament, the book of Judges. Read chapter 13, 14, 15, and 16. And when you get to chapter 16, you find one of the most dysfunctional relationships in all of Scripture. The relationship between Samson and Delilah. And I want to talk tonight a little bit about Samson and Delilah. Now, even if you've never read the Bible and never read Judges 13, 14, 15, 16, how many people before you even read that, you knew a little bit about Samson and Delilah? I mean, come, just act like you've been to Sunday school. Just fake a hand. Many of us, you know, we have a kind of cursory understanding of what goes down between Samson and Delilah. You know, brother can't get his hair cut, loses his strength, hooks up with a woman, Delilah, sets him up, winds up dying, but he kills a lot of Philistines in the process. And as you look at that, it's very easy to demonize Delilah. As a matter of fact, let me show you how demonized Delilah is. There are two women's names in the Bible you really don't want to name your daughter. Jezebel and Delilah. Now, I know the only Delilah I've ever known is the one on Radio 971 on the quiet, whatever, the music. But how many, is anybody here, you know somebody named Delilah? Anybody you know somebody? They hate it, too, don't they? They just hate being named Delilah because Delilah is synonymous with a deceitful woman, with a woman who uses her womanly ways to get what she wants. Delilah is not a Ruth in the Bible. She's not the Virgin Mary. She's not Lydia. She's not Priscilla. It's not one of those names of strong women in the Bible. When you think of Delilah, you think of a woman that's got some issues. And it's easy to hear Samson and Delilah and want to demonize Delilah. The problem is that the story of Samson begins in chapter 13. Delilah doesn't show up to chapter 16, which means you got three chapters of Samson before he shows up with Delilah. And when you read in those three chapters that precede Delilah, you will find out that Samson has some problems that he brought to the relationship with Delilah that made him susceptible to Delilah. Which is the easy way of saying this. Before he got with Delilah, he had some baggage. And everyone in here who raised their hand that was single, before you get your Adam and before you get your Eve, you got to deal with your baggage. It's easy to blame it on her, to say the problem was him. But the reality is that many of us bring some messed up past experiences that messed up our understanding of relationships that we bring into a new relationship, and we are the cause of the detrimental effects in the relationship because we've never dealt with the baggage we brought before we got with the person who we believe God has called us to be with. And you can find your Adam and find your Eve and mess it up because you just brought too much baggage. Stuff that was wrong that you never take time to examine and fix. So before we even talk about Delilah, we got to talk about you, Samson. We got to talk about what's wrong with us, some of the things we do wrong that mess up relationships that could have a godly end, but we mess them up because of our past experiences. Samson, if you look at it, part of the problem he has, as you read from chapter 13 through 16, Samson has a constant and continual need to be in a relationship. He moves from woman to woman to woman to woman. And he never takes time to sit in self-reflection and figure out that maybe he's the one with the problem. Because whenever you move from relationship to relationship to relationship, you never have time to pause and let the Holy Spirit work on you and clean up some of the damage done from the past relationship. I know the old saying is the best way to get over a man is get under another. I shouldn't have said that, but that's truth. All right. But in reality, the worst thing you can ever do is just jump from relationship to relationship without ever pausing to look in the mirror and ask, what is God trying to prune and purge in my character? Because you are never going to be positioned for your Adam as long as you got a Samson spirit bringing all this baggage from the past relationships that you've been in. Some things need to be dealt with. And one thing I want to share with you is that God will never bring your permanent partner into your life until you are pursuing your godly purpose. God will never bring a permanent partner until you're pursuing your godly purpose. And your godly purpose in life was never simply to be married. God didn't birth you just to be married. There is an assignment on your life, a purpose, and until you discover what God's purpose is and you begin to pursue it, God cannot bring your permanent partner because your permanent partner is a helpmate, but what they gonna help you do if you ain't doing nothing? What can they help you fulfill if you're not even trying to achieve something in your own life and your independent state? Yes, marriage may be on your agenda, but it's never your only assignment. And if you have no godly purpose you're fulfilling, how can God send you a helpmate? You read that story of Adam and Eve correctly. God never brings Eve into Adam's life until Adam is already caring for the garden and naming the animals and taking dominion, because it is only when he's fulfilling his divine assignment that God says, now you're ready for somebody to help you do what you recognize you've been created to do. So you got to first get your life right with the Lord and understand what God's calling you to do. Because until you do that, you really don't know who God has called and what that person can bring. That's why, and I say this with a lot of fear. That's why it can be dangerous to get married too early in your life. Because you don't know you. You're still at that entry-level stage of jobs and careers. You have no understanding of your own purpose and your vision and your dream. And it's dangerous to partner with someone permanently before you even understand what God is doing in your life. soul. When you read about Samson, before Samson hooked up with Delilah, Samson was married to another woman. You go on and read 13, 14, 15. And the sister's not, she doesn't have a name in the Bible. We know Delilah, but all we know is this woman is a Temanite. So let's give her a name so we don't have to keep calling her. Let's call Samson's first wife Timmy, huh? That's a man. That wasn't his problem. He had issues, but that wasn't it. Let's call her Tabitha. Unless, is anybody Tabitha? We have any Tabithas in here? I don't want to mess you up. So we're going to call Samson's first wife Tabitha, all right? He's married to his name Tabitha. And if you read the story, it is about as messed up as a story can be. Samson goes down into the Philistine village, sees a woman, comes back to his parents, and says, yo, go get her for me because she pleases me well. Now, there's really a lot wrong with that. Number one, he wants his mama and his daddy to go get a woman for him, and he wants the woman because she pleases him well. Mom and daddy try to talk him out of it and say, look, boy, you can't find a good Jewish girl who worships the same God you do. You mean you got to go all the way down in the Philistine and find a woman that doesn't even worship the same God you do? And knowing that this woman doesn't worship his God, he says, but she pleases me well. He's willing to sacrifice a common worship with the Lord for something that pleases him. His parents go down there. They hook it up. Boy gets married to this woman. Story gets horrible. 30 of her kinfolk show up at the wedding reception. And there's a little ego fight going on. And Samson makes a bet that he's going to tell them a riddle and they won't be able to figure it out. So he tells the riddle. The 30 kinfolk can't figure it out. And they go to Tabitha and they say, listen, tell us what the riddle is so that we can win this bet. And she sets up Samson to tell her the riddle so she can go back and tell her kinfolk. Now, part of the problem is that she has more loyalty to her kinfolk than her husband. But we ain't talking about Tabitha. We're talking about Samson. They tell Samson the riddle. Samson loses the bet, and Samson gets mad, and this is what he says. This is exactly what he says. You go home, you read chapter 14, verse 14. This is what he said. He said, if you had not plowed with my heifer, you would not have known my riddle. He gets mad. He goes down to a place called Ashkelon and goes on a killing spree. He leaves his wife to go back to his daddy. And watch what the Bible says. Her father, I can't make this up, this Bible. Her father gave Tabitha to Samson's best man. Samson comes back a few months later wanting his wife back, only to find out that his wife is now with his best man. Samson goes off and starts burning Philistine fields. In response, they come back and burn Tabitha and her daddy. And a war is created between Samson and the Philistines. That's his first relationship. Then the sun rises in chapter 15. Chapter 16, I'm sorry. And it says that Samson went down into town and found a harlot that he hooked up with. You do know what? Harlot, red hot mama. Right. He hooks up with a harlot, and the harlot sets him up to be captured by the Philistines, and he escapes. Then he falls in love with Delilah, and Delilah sets him up to be captured by the Philistines. So you don't miss this. Tabitha set him up, the harlot set him up, and Delilah set him up. And Samson never recognizes he keeps hooking up with the same kind of woman. Because when you never stop to reflect over your own character flaws, you will find yourself going through the same relationship, but the name and the face will change. He keeps hooking up with the same type of woman. And that is your inevitable outcome, to keep going through failed relationships, frustrating relationships, abusive relationships. You'd be surprised at how many women get out of an abusive relationship only to find themselves back in another one. And the problem does not just lie with the abuser. The problem lies with a sister who's got to understand, how do I keep winding up in a situation like this? So if we would take a step back and look at Samson, I'm suggesting to you tonight that Samson, as one example, has three fundamental problems that cause him to always be susceptible to a Delilah in his life. And we've got to deal with the same three in ours. Three problems Samson had that made him vulnerable to a Delilah. And they're the same three you and I have to learn to conquer in this season and stage of our life. Can I tell you what they are? Now, this comes from Bible, so please don't be mad at me. Don't send me some ugly email. I'm not talking to any of you directly, and I'm not talking about me specifically. We just talking. Right? Here's Samson's first problem. Samson has a fundamental problem defining love. Samson has a fundamental problem with what he understands as the definition of love. When you read about Samson, you're going to find he fell in love with Tabitha. He falls in love with the harlot. He falls in love with Delilah. And nowhere are we ever told that they loved him back. How could a woman set you up to be killed and you think she loves you? How could your wife want to hook up and lay with the best man from your wedding and you think that's love? Here is a fundamental problem with Samson. There's a fundamental problem with a lot of people in the world today. Samson allowed himself to fall in love by himself. God, write that down. Samson allowed himself to fall in love by himself. You may disagree, but you can't show me one instance in human-to-human love, when love is ordained by God to be a one-way street. Love requires some type of reciprocity. Love requires some type of giving back. And here's the problem. Samson says he loves a woman who gives him nothing back. And there's something fundamentally wrong with your definition of love if you can say you're in love with someone who you know is giving you nothing back. That's why your friends have a problem with him or with her. How can you say you love them? Because your friends can see they are doing nothing for you. And you're talking about you deep in love. There's something wrong with someone who's in the deep end of the pool by themselves. Somehow, some way, you don't understand love. How can you say you're in love with someone you know is giving you nothing in return? The first question I would ask you is, what does it mean to be in love? What does it take for you to love someone? And if you can tell me that you can love someone who you know brings nothing to your life, does nothing for you, shows you repeatedly they don't care, they disrespect you, they abuse, baby, something's wrong with your definition of love. Now, it may be a strong emotion, attraction, but don't call it love. Love requires some type of reciprocity. And one of the greatest things you can do to mature, let just you and me talk, because one of the greatest things you need to do to mature is check your own feelings. Put your own feelings in check when you recognize you're in the deep end of the pool all by yourself. Feelings are not always fact. And just because you feel like you're in love does not mean that that person loves you back and that you all are in love. And we all know people who've gone crazy because they couldn't check their own feelings. You've lost friends because you tried to check their feelings. And they just want to let them run wild. Love is so deceptive because it's the one emotion you just want to let out the box and let run rampant over all your life. Because you want to be in love, and we love falling in love. And there's nothing greater than love unless it ain't love. And now you're hurting yourself because you've heard me share with you the greatest lie in the world is never the lie someone else tells you. It's the lie you tell yourself. Convince yourself you're in love with a Delilah who's giving you nothing back, with a Tabitha who shows you that they don't love you in return. What does it mean to love? I can't answer that for you, but you better be able to answer that for yourself. Outside of your relationship with anyone right now, if you were to step back and be alone for a few months in your life, what would you tell yourself real love looks like? What do you need from the other person? Because if all you're doing is defining love by how you feel and what you give and what you do, what you're basically saying is, I can love someone who's doing nothing for me in return. What do you need from someone else to know you're in love? What's your love language? What are your signs of love? What does that mean for you? So the first problem I'm going to say is that Samson had a problem with defining love. Number two. I want to skip this one, but I can't. The second problem with Samson is that he allows sex to be the foundation of his relationships. Does somebody tell him, here we go. Watch what the Bible says. He falls in love with Tabitha because she pleases him well. He then goes down to the harlot, and the Bible says he stays there late at night. And then the next scene, we see him laying in Delilah's lap. Now, if you're slow, that's the Bible way of saying that Samson lacks sexual discipline. And his lack of sexual discipline makes him vulnerable to a woman who's no good but pleases him well. Now, I'm about to say something, and I have to because I'm a pastor. I think we can all acknowledge without fear of contradiction, or at least looking like you're the most god-awful sinner in here, that the will of the Lord is for your sexual relationship and your sexual intimacy to be contained and restrained in a marital covenant commitment. I've got to say that to you, that the will of the Lord is for you to restrain and contain your sexual relationship to a marital relationship that's a covenant commitment with the Lord. God's will for you is to only be sexual with your spouse. We can agree on that and acknowledge it. Now, I have to say that, but I know for many of us, that ain't gonna change behavior. Because we live in a world where if anything has become ethically relative, it is sexuality. That we are raised in a generation that, if the truth be told, feel very little guilt about having sex outside of marriage. This is CAYA, we can be real, right? Right? Let's just be real. There's some of us in here tonight who are still virginal, and I praise God for your witness and your testimony. But for the other 99% of us, okay. You know the folk you came in here with, you little girl, he ain't talking about you. I know you. Ooh, ain't nobody on this pew. For many of us, that ship sailed a long time ago. And the reality is that the more sexually active you are, the less you feel the condemning spirit of the Holy Spirit. The convicting of the Holy Spirit, excuse me. So saying what God's will is in our generation is typically not enough to change our sexual behavior. And so one of the things the Lord began to press upon me is the need to talk about the other dangers that are involved in sexuality when it comes to discerning God's will for a relationship. Samson is not ever going to be ready for a woman called to him by the Lord because he has not developed sexual discipline yet. And whenever you are sexually unrestrained and sexually active outside of God's will, you've already positioned yourself in a place where you will not be in position to receive who Adam or Eve will be, because you are standing in direct disobedience to God's will. How do you expect God to bless you with whom God wants you to have, but you decide not to follow God's road to get there? And one of the words we don't like to speak about, but is real critical in single, saved life, is celibacy. An absolute restraint from sexual activity until marriage. And even speaking it seems awkward because you hear it and there's something inside of you that there's no way you can do it. Like the devil already convinces you, you can't do it. Because this is just your pattern, that this is normative in the world. But I want to suggest to you that if you are serious about a God-ordained relationship, at some point, you've got to commit yourself to sexual celibacy. Or you know what? You're going to go from Tabitha to harlot to Delilah to Tabitha to harlot to Delilah. And at some point, you've got to recognize the road you're on always leads to the same destination. See, I knew it was going to get quiet. That's a difficult word to share and to receive. That celibacy is God's will for us as singles. Not simply because of what the word teaches, but in practical sense, you all, sex clouds your discernment about the other important issues and character traits that are necessary to make a relationship work. You know what sex is? Sex is the strongest Tylenol you can take in a relationship. It won't cure anything, but it'll make you feel better for a while. And it causes you to ignore stuff that you know ain't right. All of us, not all, I shouldn't say that, because there's some virgins in the house, and I thank God for your witness. But for the 99% of the rest of us, have you ever been a place you knew you had to break up, the stuff just was jacked up, but sex kept you in something you should have got out of? See, let me tell you how convicting that is, because you can't even say amen. You don't want nobody to know. You ain't talking to me. Sex pushes you into a place where it's hard for you to discern, where you can't hear what God is trying to share with you and say to you about what is and isn't right. Tweet this correctly, please. This may be the best tweet of the night. You can't hear God's whisper when you ignore God's shout. You can't hear God whisper about the other things in this relationship if you're ignoring God's shout that you all shouldn't be sexual. So the Lord's been hollering at you about your sexuality. You're ignoring that, but then praying to God give you discernment about the other things, about whether this is the right person or not. And God says, you can't hear my whisper because you're ignoring my shout. You want me to talk about the finance and the career and about children and jobs. But you can't hear me talk about that when you're ignoring me tell you you're not supposed to be sexual. God. Somebody say that's a tough word. Couldn't even say that right, folks. Just quiet about that. Lord have mercy. Because of his undisciplined sexuality, he's never in a position to receive anything more than a Delilah. And I think one of the greatest things that we can be as a witness to this world are saved single folk who acknowledge that we struggle but are serious about a commitment to live holy and pure in our sexuality. So let me ask you this. What do you remove from the relationship if removing sex destroys it? Right? If it's God ordained and meant to be, and that's not, and you take that off the table and that's not part of it, what have you really lost? And if it crumbles without that, then you already know this wasn't what God wanted for you. Don't let sex cloud your discernment. All right, number one. Let's get out of here. It's past time. Number one, he has a problem defining love. Number two, he allows sex to be the foundation of his relationship. Number three, and this is something that I know has affected me in life, he never seeks God's will for his relationships. He never seeks God's will for it. You know what Samson is? Samson is the strongest man in the Bible, and you'll find that whenever he's tied up, he prays and the Spirit of the Lord descends strong upon him. But he never prayed before he got into a relationship with a woman. And I would argue that the same Spirit that strengthened him in the time of battle is the same Spirit that could have strengthened him in his relationships if he had ever sought and wondered and wanted what God willed for him in his relationship. And as I said in the beginning, many of us go about relationships thinking we're strong enough to make it work, and then when it doesn't work, we invite God in. Have you ever stepped out of a relationship to fast and pray and ask God to reveal his will for you in a relationship? Do you even care what God's will is in a relationship, or do you just want what you want? And I know my biggest fault in life has always been just going after what I want, making it happen, and then finding out it may not have been the will of the Lord, and praying for God to help get me out of something that God never wanted me to be in the first place. Because we deceive ourselves into thinking we can make what we want work. Do you want God's will for your relationship? Do you want who God wants for you? Are you willing to pray about it and surrender to it? My dad gave me a statement once, and I want to pass it on to you. And I think it's relevant about relationships. My dad said, it's hard for me to be on an airplane when there's turbulence if I wasn't on the airplane when it took off. You can't take off and hit bumps and expect me to be on something that I wasn't invited on before it took off. Can the Lord say the same thing? It's hard for you to want me to be in the middle of a relationship that's turbulent when you never sought my presence in the relationship before it began. And if your relationships are the one area in your life you don't pray over, I promise you that's the area you're going to struggle in the most. That's the area you're going to be dissatisfied in the most. Because whatever you don't cover in prayer is one area you're the most vulnerable in. How many people are familiar with some Greek mythology? I used to love reading Greek mythology. Anybody ever remember one of the Greek gods named Achilles? You know Achilles? Okay, Achilles. Achilles is the messenger of the god, fleet-footed, very fast, and he's invulnerable. His skin is impenetrable. Knives, arrows, nothing can penetrate his skin. And the reason Achilles is invulnerable is that when he was a child, his mother grabbed him by his ankles and dipped him in this water that made him impenetrable to knives and spears. And so she pulled him up, and he's wet. All of his body is now covered, and none of this area is vulnerable. But anybody who knows, Achilles was vulnerable in one area. Achilles heel, that's where we get the term Achilles heel, right? He's vulnerable here. You wanna know why he's vulnerable here? Because that's where his mother held him. And that's the area that wasn't covered when she dipped him. And so the very area that was not exposed is the area that he was vulnerable to. Right? Whatever area of your life you're covering and not exposing to God in prayer is always going to be the area you're the most vulnerable to attack in. So if you don't pray over your finances, that's where you're going to get hurt. If you won't pray over your sexuality, that's where you're going to get hurt. If you won't pray over your relationships, that's where you're going to get hurt. And the challenge I want to lay before you tonight to join in with me is to go into a season of praying God's will for your romantic life. I know you like him. I know you love her. And if it's God's will, it can sustain 30 days of prayer. I want you to be serious about that commitment to celibacy. What an awesome witness we can have to the world when we allow ourselves to be disciplined in our sex lives. I want you to be in a place where you check your own emotions. Don't think you're in love simply because you feel warm and fuzzy. Ask the question, are they giving back? Don't fall in love by yourself. Now, what I want to do to close is to call some people to prayer with me. Because I know that a lot of what I shared is difficult, even for me to hear and say. And there's no way we can commit ourselves to anything God has spoken to tonight without being in prayer. You can sit, you can stand, or if you want to come to the altar, I know it's not for everyone, and I do me a favor, let somebody come to the altar without you trying to figure out why. All right? Because God's speaking to someone tonight about some changes you've got to make. And here's what the Bible says, that the Lord can sow a seed in your life, and before you get home to reap the fruit, the devil tries to pull it up already. So for somebody, there's going to be a temptation waiting for you the minute you check your phone. It's going to try to pull what God just put in you out of you. All right? Because the devil don't want you to harvest this seed.